I would like to welcome all the participants. And first of all, I'd like to welcome Mr. Murumkar Yogesh Prabhakar, Director and Corporate Trainer at Machine Learning, Blockchain, Data Science, and Big Data Analytics at Bharat Soft Solutions, Pune, Maharashtra. And Mr. Murumkar has completed his graduation and post-graduation from Pune University in Computer Data Science and Big Data Analytics. He's an enthusiast for more than 10 years of experience, including IT experience and teaching and training experience. Worked for Capgemini India Private Limited for 4 years and worked for clients like Breckles and S. Punky Bank. Has successfully trained more than 300 participants for global certification in data science and big data analytics by Dell EMC. And many other achievements to go on. And he has been a global certified trainer in data science and big data analytics, and also a Microsoft certified Python developer, and has been he has a very good practical hands-on skills, including tools, technologies, Unix, then Tableau licensed, Power BI, Hadoop, etc., and conducted various trainings and workshops related to machine learning, deep learning, blockchain, big data analytics, and data science for students and professionals at various colleges and universities. Currently, he is training a batch of 100 students and professionals for certification exam in data science and big data analytics. And he also at Interdisciplinary School of Scientific Computing and Department of School of Energy Studies, Savitribai Pune University, Maharashtra. And there are many things to go on onto the list. And he has a total of 10 years of experience, 4 years of IT, and 6 years of training and teaching. And I welcome you, sir, for this session. I welcome all the participants for this beautiful session and webinar and Python, which is a hands-on training. And plus, I request all the participants to wait after the session, since there will be a feedback session, and plus there will be distribution of e-certificates. So I request sir to continue with the session. I hand on this session to Mr. Yogesh Guru. Please welcome.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam, for the introduction. So yes, first of all, good morning, all of you. Let me just give a brief introduction about myself. As madam has already introduced me, yes, but let me just tell you some things, and after that we can start. So my name is Yogesh Murumkar. I have a total 10 plus years of experience, and which includes 4 years of IT industry experience. I have worked in Capgemini in business intelligence domain for 4 years. And after that, I have continued in teaching and training in different domains, as madam has already told. And since the last 2 years, I have started my own company, that is Bharat Soft Solutions in Pune, Kothur. So we people work in development as well as training part. Okay, so this is in brief about me. Now, let's try to come to today's topic. So what I will do is, I will try to keep this particular session as a practical session, so that you people will be able to get at least something from these 2 hours. Okay, so we will try to make it interesting. So what I need from you people is patience. Wait for some time. Okay, and let me tell you one more thing. Whatever I'll be discussing in these 2 hours, right? It may be any application, it may be deployment, it may be any project, right? So Everything about that. It may be code, it may be document, detailed documents I'll be sharing with all of you. So you don't have to worry about all those things, whether I will be able to get the code and all those things. Yes, definitely. I'll be sharing each and everything. Whatever I am discussing, I am going to discuss in this 2 hours. Because generally people, they have questions, right? Whether they are going to get those codes and all those things, right? You will be getting all those things today at the end. That is for sure. So don't worry about that. Right? And next thing is, if someone is having questions in between, what we can do is, you people wait till the end, and maybe last 10 to 15 minutes we can have question and answer sessions. That is also possible. And in case if I am not able to answer some of your questions, I will be sharing my contacts and everything. You people can go and you people can go and contact anytime. Okay, so don't worry about all those things. I will be sharing my contact. I will be sharing all the contents, the code, and the documentation. That is one thing. Now, straightforward, let me come to the agenda, today's agenda. What are we going to discuss today? Okay. So let me just share my screen so that I will be able to explain in a proper way. Okay, let me just open this one. So I hope everyone is able to see my screen. So first thing I will do is, I will try to give you a brief idea about today's session. So yes, I already told you, those people who are having questions, we can discuss all the questions at the end of the session, right? So, and don't worry about documentation, because some people, they have already asked me, so that's why I just tried to clear that particular point. Okay, let me come to the agenda of the session. As madam has told that this session will be about Python, so what I will do is, as I have been told that there are some students and there are some faculties who are the participants for this session, so I will try to start with the basic thing. I am hoping that you people are aware about basic Python at least. Okay. If not, but see, whatever the code and all those things, whatever I am going to discuss, we will be able to understand it. Don't worry about that. So it depends. It depends on time duration. See, I also agree that within 2 hours, it is not at all possible to cover everything. Right? I will try to give you a best idea about all these applications. Right? I will try to execute it on my machine. What you people can do is, once you get the code and documentation of every application, whatever I am going to discuss, you people can go and try it out on your machines afterwards. Okay? You can ask me questions at any time. I'll be telling you how you can go and you can proceed with that. Okay? So first of all, let me go and try to give you an idea about today's agenda. What topics we are going to discuss here. Okay. So see, I will again repeat. According to my information, right, I am expecting that there are some students and some faculty also. So there might be some senior people also who are attending the sessions. Right, so they might be knowing about some of the things here. So I will try to keep it as a mixture of both. Right, so that students will also be able to understand, as well as the senior faculty members or those who are experienced. Right, they also will be able to understand, because we have a time limit. That thing we need to keep into mind. Right, so that's why I told you, just have some patience, and I will be trying to discuss all those things, whatever I am going to tell you about here in agenda. So the first point I am going to start with is about introduction. So as madam has told that we are going to discuss about Python. So yeah, Python we'll try to see how you can use native use of Python language in terms of machine learning, right? And I will just try to give you an idea about that, right? So first of all, what I will do is, I will try to discuss about what do you mean by machine learning. So a simple definition of machine learning, or we will just try to understand what is this term, okay, machine learning. Then we will try to discuss about what is data science. In a brief, I will try to give you an idea about this particular term. Right. After that, we will also try to talk about something called as deep learning. So I am going to start with the theoretical part, and then slowly I will move into the implementation of that. Okay. After deep learning, I will also try to talk about something called as AI, that is artificial intelligence. So yes, and after discussing all these terms, you will also be able to understand the difference between all these terms, because many of you might have come across these terms many number of times, right? So yes, we will talk about machine learning, we will talk about data science, we will talk about deep learning, we will talk about artificial intelligence, and along with this, I will try to discuss about, or I will try to tell you where the terms like computer vision going to come, where the terms like neural network is going to come. Or for that matter, what do you understand by natural language processing, NLP? Because everything is going to revolve around this one, artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is the bigger umbrella. So yes, we will try to differentiate all these terms, and we will try to see one by one in a simple language. We will try to understand all these terms. Right? Now, once I am done with that, what I will do is, I will try to give you, or I will try to discuss about a very basic term, that is nothing but data. We will try to see what is data. And after that, we will try to see different types of data, because without data, you cannot do anything. Data is the oil. Data is the oil, right? Without data, nothing is possible. If you say, okay, I want to create a model, I want to create a prediction model in machine learning, right? With the help of Python language. So what you need data. And that's why it's very, very necessary to understand what is data actually, right? And after that, obviously, we will go and we will try to discuss about types of data, different types of data and their examples. And we will try to understand each one of them with a simple example. Once that is done, I will try to discuss about different approaches which are used in machine learning or machine learning approaches. So we will see there are different types, different approaches of machine learning for solving machine learning problems. We will try to discuss one by one. Once that is done, the fourth point I am going to discuss is the first application. We will create an application, right, in Python language, and that application will be voice assistant, right? So with the help of basic Python, that's why I told you this particular session is going to be a mix of both, right? So yeah, experienced people, those who might be knowing about some of these things already, for them also and for students also, I will just try to mix up both the things, right? So the first application which I am going to implement on the machine, right? Here I will be implementing this particular application, voice assistant. What it is going to do is, suppose if I will give a voice command. Suppose if I say open YouTube, so that application is going to open YouTube. If I say play songs, so it is going to play the song. And don't worry, as I told you that I'll be sharing the code and everything with all of you. So don't worry about that. You will be able to run this particular application onto your machine. Now I will tell you why I discuss this particular application. What is the point of discussing this application here? We will discuss that. Next application which I am going to discuss, which is again developed with the help of basic Python language, that is application 2, is about decision review system. Now you people might be watching cricket matches, right? Many of you might be watching cricket matches. So in cricket matches, you might have seen there is something called as DRS system, right? Decision review system. So when to use DRS system? So you might be knowing, right? When the on-field umpire is not sure about the decision, right? Whether the player is out or not out, right? So in that case, that on-field umpire can go and make use of something called as decision review system, right? So what we will be doing is, we will be implementing this particular application with the help of basic Python. This application is going to accept video as an input, right? And then I will show you how you can implement decision review kind of system with the help of Python. So yeah, again, it will be with the help of basic Python only. Right? Again, same thing. I'll be sharing the code with all of you. Right? Now, the sixth point I'm going to discuss is, I will show you an end-to-end project which is developed in Python. Right? Which is developed in Python using some framework. Because frameworks are the thing which we need for implementation of the for implementation of the applications in real time. So we will develop an end-to-end project which will be developed in Python, and what this project is going to do is, it is going to fetch all the reviews, all the comments, customer name from e-commerce like Flipkart. I will show you. From Flipkart website, this particular application or project will be able to fetch real-time comments, real-time reviews given by the customer for a particular product. For example, if I enter, the application will be like this. If I enter, suppose iPhone. So for iPhone, on Flipkart e-commerce website, what people are saying about that particular product, those comments from the Flipkart website will be fetched by our application, and those comments will be real-time comments. Comments, reviews, ratings, customer name, and the product name. All these things it is going to fetch. Right? So yeah, it is going to be really very interesting. And I will tell you how you people can go and you can do these kind of projects for other e-commerce websites, maybe for Amazon, maybe for First Cry, right? And there are a number of government portals also from which we will be able to fetch the real-time data, the way we will be fetching the real-time data from the Flipkart website, right? Now, so that will be an end-to-end project. I will be explaining you how to implement that. Now, once that is done, as I told you that, I will be showing you how to deploy that project onto cloud. So deployment of this project, which we have discussed in the sixth point, deployment of project onto cloud. So how, what happens in real time, right? How to deploy a project, how to deploy application onto cloud. Now, why to deploy anything onto cloud? Because if you do not deploy application or project onto cloud, other people will not be able to use it, right? For example, WhatsApp. As WhatsApp is already on a cloud, that's why all of us are able to use it from anywhere, from any place in the world, right? So the same way, I'll be showing you how to deploy this particular project onto cloud. And what I will do is, I'll be sending you the link for this particular deployed project in the chat box. and you people will also be able to go and use that particular application onto your machine, right? So that is one thing we will try to talk about, the deployment. Here I'll be showing you everything step by step, and I will be explaining you all those steps, right? And for this, a detailed documentation is created for these two things, each and everything, with screenshot, with explanation, right? I have created a detailed document, a PDF I'll be sharing. Now after that, if time permits, right, if we have more time, then only I will go and I will try to show you one more project with the help of one algorithm that is called as linear regression, which is the basic algorithm in case of machine learning, right? If we have time, then I'm going to show you this particular project, right? It all depends on how much time is going to be there, right? Because there are a lot of things I'm trying to cover. So, but sure, 7 points definitely I'm going to cover, and you will be able to understand that is for sure. So if time permits, we will try to discuss linear regression project. So what is linear regression? And in this case also, I'll be showing you a hands-on project, a practical, right? And then your task will be what? Your task will be to deploy that particular project onto cloud, right? Now I told you that why am I discussing these two applications? What is the point of discussing this fourth and fifth point? Because here in the seventh point, you will be learning about deployment of a project onto cloud, right? Now your task will be to deploy these two applications onto cloud the way I'll be showing you, right? The same way you will have to follow, and you will have to deploy this application and this application onto cloud, right? And talking about cloud, generally I teach five clouds: AWS, Amazon Web Services, Azure, Google Cloud Platform. Then there is one that is called as Heroku Cloud. So and like this, there are other clouds also, like Alibaba Cloud and all those things. So here the cloud platform I'll be using is Heroku, which is free for 2 years, right? And how to create a Heroku account, again that particular thing also shown you. It is actually already documented in the PDF which I'll be sharing with you, right? Now so that is about the agenda. These are the points which we are going to discuss here, right? So I will just try to go according to this order. So first of all, I am going to discuss about machine learning, data science, deep learning, artificial intelligence. Then what is data, types of data, then machine learning approaches. Then first application will be voice assistant application in Python, then DRS system, then end-to-end Python project for fetching the Flipkart reviews, comments and ratings given by the customer in real time, and deployment of that project. And if time permits, we will try to go and we will try to see one more project which is actually based on first algorithm of machine learning, that is linear regression. Okay. So this is the first thing. This is the first thing which I wanted to tell you. Okay. Now let me just save this particular file and let me clear. And now I will try to discuss. I will try to start with the first point itself. That is nothing but introduction. So introduction to all those terms, whatever I have shown you. So let's try to start with that particular point. Okay. So here, as I told you, we will be discussing about the first thing. We'll be discussing about AI. And that is nothing but artificial intelligence. And we will try to see the difference between AI and all the other terms which are related to AI. Right? AI is nothing but artificial intelligence. After that, here, once we discuss about AI, once we talk about AI, I will try to talk about machine learning. Right? So let's see what is this machine learning. Once we discuss about machine learning, I will try to discuss about the next term, that is the thing of deep learning. Okay. So as all these terms are related and how all these terms are related, we will try to discuss that particular. And once deep learning is done, finally we will try to discuss about what is the concept of data science. There are a lot of definitions possible about data science you might have come across, right? But here we will try to just understand the concept. That is the only motive. Just try to understand all these concepts, right? Now let's try to start with the AI. Let me give a explanation about all these terms in the simple diagram. So suppose if AI is represented like this, if this is the area which is covered by artificial intelligence, right? So artificial intelligence. Now what is artificial intelligence is, in simple words, artificial intelligence is nothing but to enable computers or to enable machines to think, right? To enable computers to think like human beings, right? That is nothing but artificial intelligence, as simple as that. Okay. So AI is nothing but to enable computers or to enable machines to think like human beings, as simple as that. And always remember, the bigger umbrella is always going to be artificial intelligence only. Now let me go, and again I will say that there are a lot of definitions of AI possible, but here we are just trying to understand the concept. Okay, machine learning. So machine learning generally comes inside artificial intelligence. As I already told you, that AI is going to be the bigger umbrella. So machine learning is going to come inside AI. Now, what is machine learning? How can I define machine learning? If I want to define machine learning in simple words, you can write down, machine learning is just bunch of tools. It is just bunch of tools, bunch of statistical tools, rather I will say. It's a bunch of statistical tools. For what? For to learn from what? To learn from something called as data. Right? So machine learning is nothing but a bunch of statistical tools to learn from data. As simple as that. Right? What are those bunch of statistical tools? We will try to talk about that. Right? So AI is nothing but to enable computers or machines to think like humans. Machine learning is just a bunch of statistical tools to learn from data. Right. Now let's try to come to the next term, and that is nothing but deep learning. So deep learning is going to come inside machine learning. So somewhere here, this is deep learning. Now what is deep learning? How you can define deep learning? So deep learning is actually a much more recent term. Maybe since 2006 or 7, it has been there in the market. Right. So that's why I say that machine learning is a much more recent term. And what is deep learning is a much more recent term. And what is deep learning actually is? Deep learning is all about using something called as multi-layered neural network. Right. So deep learning is nothing but using something called as multi-layered neural network. Now, what is neural network is? Neural network is actually generated neurons. Neurons are present in human world. Right. So. But see, as I told you, we have some limitation here, so I cannot go and discuss this multi-layered neural network in detail, right? So we have some limitations. That's why we will have to follow the instructions. Our basic point will be to discuss about the Python applications and the project which are developed with the help of Python, right? So try to understand deep learning. As I told you, that it is a much more recent term. Since 2006-07, it is there in the market, and it is all about using something called as multi-layered neural network. Right now, if you see, there is a huge impact of artificial intelligence, what people refer to as Google's AI system. Some of you might have heard about something called as Google's artificial intelligence system. So it's a very famous system. If you go and try to Google about Google's AI systems, you will see a lot of information on the internet. Right? Now, actually, this Google's AI system, which is very famous, they are mostly referring to Google's deep learning system. And that's why deep learning is very, very important. This particular thing, Google's AI system, which is very famous, is actually most of the time it is referring to Google's deep learning system. Right? And so some of the most important approaches in artificial intelligence, right? I will again repeat, some of the most important approaches in artificial intelligence in last 10 to 12 years have been happening in this small area, and that is nothing but deep learning. And that's why deep learning has got a lot of importance, right? But obviously, as you can see from the figure on this particular Venn diagram, that deep learning actually comes inside machine learning, right? That's why one should have a knowledge of machine learning, at least some basic knowledge of machine learning, to learn about deep learning. Okay, now we talked about all these terms: machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning. Now let's move and try to talk about something called as data science. And now you might have heard about data science a lot of times. This is a buzzing word actually nowadays, right? So many of you have come across this particular term, right? But let me tell you, it is not like that it is something new. It was already there, but yeah, obviously the naming convention is always going to be there, right? Now where data science is going to come into picture here? So data science is going to come somewhere here. right? This will be data science, right? Now, that you can see from this particular Venn diagram that data science has some overlap with artificial intelligence techniques, with machine learning techniques, and not so much overlap with deep learning techniques, right? But you can see here, data science has its own areas also. So this area you can see, data science has its own area also. Right? That means data science has something extra other than all these things. Right? So in a nutshell, in a brief, what I can say is, data science is all about understanding. This is a simple, again, it is not a bookish definition. It is just for your understanding purpose. Right? Data science, I can say, it is all about understanding or making sense out of the data. Understanding or making sense of data, that is nothing but data science, right? And you might have heard about something called as visualization, right? So you might have heard about this particular term, visualization. So visualizing data is a very important aspect of data science. And for all of these areas, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, data science, right? For all these areas, there are some fundamental tools which are actually used. Now, what are those fundamental tools? Let's try to talk about all those fundamental tools here, right? So whether I talk about machine learning, whether I talk about deep learning, artificial intelligence, data science, all of them, they are going to make use of some fundamental tools. For example, there is something called as probability. So, right, I told you, statistical tools. So these are the statistical tools. Probability is a statistical tool. So data science, machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence, all of them, they are going to make use of this statistical tool, that is probability. There is another statistical tool, that is statistics, you are going to make use of. There is something called as linear algebra. Right, now some of you might have come across all these terms, maybe in 11th standard, 12th standard, or maybe in school, or maybe in your graduation, right? So linear algebra, there is something called as matrix algebra. So all these statistical tools, we are going to need to implement all these things, right? Whether it is artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, whatever it may be, all these things you are going to need to implement for implementing data science, deep learning, machine learning, AI, right? Other than these things, there are other statistical tools also. For example, there is something called as numerical optimization, right? So yes, numerical optimization is also going to come under fundamental tools or statistical tools. And don't forget something very important, without which we cannot implement, that is nothing but computer program, right? So these are the fundamental tools one is going to need to learn all these terms or to implement all these terms, data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning, right? So all these statistical tools, fundamental tools, we are going to require, okay? So, okay, see, someone is saying that my voice is not audible. Can other people, can you please confirm if I am audible or not? Please say yes or no, because I think Roshan Kumar is saying that, sir, you are audible, you are not audible clearly. Can you please confirm other people? If I am audible, please say yes. Otherwise, please say no. Let me just confirm. Just a minute, Roshan. Yes, Roshan, many of them, they are saying that I am audible. Right. Now see, for some people, if there is some problem with the audio, what you can do is, because I am already using a very good connection here, so there should not be a problem from my side about internet speed, because it's a very good speed actually. Yeah, I can see that many people are saying that I am audible clearly. So Roshan, what you can do is, if there is some problem, you can drop off and again join, right? You can drop off and again join, try it out, okay. And let me know if some problem is there. Okay. So what I was discussing is, I was telling you that these are the fundamental tools one should learn if you want to implement all these things, right? Now computer programming can be, you can use any language for as a computer programming language, right? It can be Python, it can be R language, it can be Java language, right? It depends on your expertise, right? Now some people might go and develop all these things in C or C++ also, that's also possible. Or you might have heard about something called as new language, which is actually coming in the market, that is called as Julia. Right. So language doesn't matter. What matters is all these concepts. If these concepts are clear, right, and if you know some algorithms, that is what is not going to change. Language, obviously, today if it is Python, there might be some other language, right? So I'm not saying that the language is the only thing which is very, very important. Other things like this are also very, very important. So all these things, whatever I have written here, these are nothing but the fundamental tools or statistical tools that one should know if he or she wants to learn about data science, machine learning, deep learning, and artificial intelligence. Right? To try to understand, these are the things which one should have knowledge about. Right? And language doesn't matter. It can be Python, it can be R, it can be Java, C, C++, Julia, it can be anything. Right? Now, I also told you that I'll be telling you when we discuss agenda. I told you that I will let you know where the terms like computer vision is going to come into picture. So computer vision is going to come into picture somewhere here. Right? There is something called as NLP, natural language processing. So obviously, natural language processing also is also going to make use of deep learning, data science, machine learning, AI. Computer vision is also going to come somewhere here. Right. So whether it is computer vision, natural language processing, or whether it is deep learning, machine learning, so everything, most of the times you will see that everything is going to come under this particular term, that is nothing but artificial intelligence. That's why I said artificial intelligence is a bigger umbrella. Now, even though I have discussed all these things, right, I will say that these are not the only definitions. There are other definitions also possible. There are a lot of definitions you might have come across. Many people will say that, okay, data science and artificial intelligence, they are same. To some extent, yes, they are same. You can see, right, there is an overlap. There is an overlap between them. So, if someone is saying that, okay, data science and artificial intelligence are same, yes, they can be correct to some extent. But the actual difference is this one. This particular Venn diagram is going to make the concept very clear. What is the differentiation between all these terms? So I hope everyone is able to understand the difference between data science, machine learning, deep learning, and AI. Right? This is a simple introduction. Right? I will again repeat, this is not the only definition. Right? Because in books or in some articles, you will come across different definitions, and there are a lot of definitions. And all these areas are massive. For example, if you talk about machine learning, it's a very huge area. Right? And out of all these areas, if you talk about deep learning is a fast evolving area. Right? So generally, whenever I cover some topics, what I do is I try to cover in my courses also, I try to cover the fundamental things and the things which are important and the things which are widely used. I try to cover all those things in my courses, because what happens is on the basis of those fundamental things or the things which we widely use in machine learning, deep learning, AI, data science. On those things, what people can do is people can explore. People can try to learn more. Because if I talk about deep learning is never ending. Machine learning is never ending. That's why I told you all these terms are massive. They are a very, very huge areas. Right? If you say that okay, I can complete deep learning, it's not possible. It's never ending. Right? Because there are number of evolutions. The deep learning term itself is a fast evolving. There are a lot of things which are going on in this area. That's why I say that there can be different definitions also, which you might have come across. Right? I'm not saying that this is the only definition, but yeah, okay. With the help of this particular definition, you will be able to clear the concept at least. What is deep learning? What is data science? Right? So I hope everyone is able to understand or got an idea about all these terms. Now what I will do is I will try to move to the next point, which I told you that I'll be discussing. So the next point I want to discuss is about a basic term. Again, this is a very, very basic term, but important. So what I will do is I will try to discuss about this basic term, that is nothing but data. Okay. Again, many of you might be already knowing about data, but yeah, as it's a basic and important term, that's why I'm discussing it here. Now, what is data? So if I want to define data, data is just a raw material, right? But there is something called as information also. Now, what is the difference between data and information? So information is processed data, you can say. Data is a raw material and information is processed data. For example, if someone is saying that there is something which is having a cone shape, there is something which is old, and there is something which is sweet, right? If something is giving you this kind of data, right? So, but it is called as ice cream. This is information, right? If someone is saying that there is something which is in the cone shape, which is cold and sweet, so this is nothing but data. But it is called as ice cream is information, right? So this is a simple example to differentiate between the data and information. So data is a raw material and information is a processed data, and that's why we always need information. That's why you might have heard about something called like exploratory data analysis. It's a process which actually is done before developing any project in machine learning or data science. So in that case, what happens is they try to process the data. That is, they try to convert raw data into information. So data is a raw material and information is a processed data. So with this example, I hope you people are clear. Now let me go and try to discuss about different types of data. So there are different types of data which are possible. Again, here also you might have come across some of the terms, but some of these terms might be new for you. For example, the first type of data you might have heard about is structured data. So let's try to see what is structured data. After that, we will try to see what do you mean by semi-structured data. So we will try to see the example of a semi-structured data, and with the example we will try to understand what is semi-structured data. After that, we will try to talk about something called as quasi-structured data. So here I will try to give a simple example so that you can remember the concept of quasi-structured data. So this is the third type of data, that is quasi-structured data. And there is fourth type of data you might have heard about, many of you might have heard about it many times, and that is nothing but unstructured data. So why are we discussing about data here? Because without data, nothing is possible. What you need is data only. If you want to discuss about machine learning, if you want to develop different projects in machine learning, deep learning, data science, computer vision, artificial intelligence, it may be anything, data analytics, business analytics, you are going to need data. And data can be of any type out of all these four types, right? So structured data, semi-structured data, quasi-structured data, and unstructured data. Now let's see what is structured data. So always remember, structured data is also called as relational data, right? Now what do you mean by this particular term, relation? So always remember, relation in database terminology always means table. That means what is structured data? That means structured data is a tabular data. That means the data which you can store in the tabular format is called as structured data, or the data which you can store in the row and column format, that is nothing but structured data. For example, tabular data is called as structured data, right? So these are the rows, right? And these are the columns. So if you are able to save some data like this, those will be the structured data. Now, which are the different examples of databases or data which is structured? For example, you might be knowing about Microsoft Excel. So Microsoft Excel is nothing but structured data. It can store structured data. There are other databases also, right? Some of you might be knowing about some database that is MySQL. MySQL can store the data in tabular format. So yes, it's also an example of structured data. There is a database like Oracle. Oracle also can store the data in tabular format. So yes, it's also an example of structured data. And there are lot of examples which you can give for structured data, right? So I hope simple definition of structured data is relational data. And as I told you, relational data is nothing but the data which you can store in the tabular format. That is, the data which you can store in the row and column format, that is called as structured data. As simple as. Okay. Now let's try to talk about the second type of data, that is semi-structured data. Now semi-structured data, the best example of semi-structured data is XML database. Right. Now why XML database is the example of semi-structured data? Some of you who are interested to develop different websites, you might have seen about scripting language, right? So what we do in HTML language, XML language, we write down some tags. For example, I want to write down name. For example, I want to write down this name. Okay. So I will use angular brackets, or it is called as tags. Suppose I want to write down the name as Sachin, right? Now this Sachin is written in single quote, so I will close that particular tag like this. So this is the code in HTML, right? This is how we write down the code in HTML. So here I wanted to store this particular name, but what I use data as well as the code. That means the mixture of the data and the code is called as semi-structured data. And that's why I told you XML database right? It's the best example of semi-structured data. So this is the example, because it is having code as well as data. And that's why it is semi-structured data. Okay, so yeah, semi-structured data can be one of the sources for creating the models. Okay, now there comes another term that is called as quasi-structured data. So what do you understand by quasi-structured data? Let's try to talk about that. The best example of quasi-structured data is clickstream data. Now, what do you mean by clickstream data? Right. So clickstream data is nothing but, for example, let me open the browser and let me show you what is clickstream data. So I will click on the browser, I will open the browser, I will open a new tab. And here, suppose if I go to Google, right? Now in the Google, if I try to search about India, right, press enter, and you will be able to see that there is a change in the address bar, right? Suppose if I go and click on this particular link, this particular result, India, right? Now you will be able to notice that there will be a change in the address bar once again. Now see, if I click, now see the contents of the address bar are changed. I am highlighting that, right? So the contents of the address bar are going to change. So whenever I am clicking on something, the contents of the address bar are changing. So see, again it is changed. So this is nothing but clickstream data. This is the best example of clickstream data. Right. Now where you can make use of this kind of data? So for example, if I want to create some application which is going to find out which types of websites a particular person visits most of the times, right? So what I can do is I can take his clickstream data into some text file, save it, and I can apply word count on that, right? Or I can apply some program, I can write down some program for that. I will be able to know, okay, this type of website is actually generally visited most of the times by this particular person. So that is the example of clickstream data. That means the data which you get in the address bar after clicking on the different results. That is the example of clickstream data, right? And which is actually called as quasi-structured data. So I hope you people are able to understand quasi-structured data itself. Right. Now let's try to come to the next or the last type of data, that is nothing but unstructured data. And many of you might have heard about unstructured data. So there are a lot of examples about unstructured data. For example, if I want to give the examples, there are a lot of examples. For example, audio data is unstructured data. Right. Video data is unstructured data. There can be some data which is coming from sensors also. So sensor data can be an example of unstructured data, right? Image data can be an example of unstructured data, or maybe phone calls, right? Phone calls, generally we try to store recordings of the phone calls. Phone calls is a type of unstructured data, right? So audio, video, images, right? Email data is also unstructured data. There might or the okay. Sundar Kulkarni, I will repeat what is quasi-structured data once I am done with this. Okay. So email can be example of unstructured data. Now there can if you talk about WhatsApp data. So WhatsApp data is also an example of unstructured data, right? In WhatsApp, we see smileys and emojis and all those things. So WhatsApp data can be example of unstructured data, or for that matter, you can say social media data is also the example of unstructured data. Now social media, whenever I say social media, what do you mean by that? That means the data can be from Facebook, the data can be from Twitter, it can be from Instagram, right? It can be from LinkedIn. There are a lot of sources, right? So all these things, or in simple words, you can say that the data which you cannot store in tabular form, that is unstructured data, right? These are the examples: audio, video, sensor data, image data, phone calls, email, WhatsApp data, social media data like Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram. All these are the examples. Or YouTube data is also unstructured data, right? So I hope everyone is able to understand structured data, semi-structured data, quasi-structured data, and unstructured data, right? Now one of you have asked me, Sundar Kulkarni, I asked one question, that what is quasi-structured data, right? So I told you that the best example of quasi-structured data is clickstream data. Now what do you mean by this? That means, suppose if I go to Google, www.google.com, right? And in Google I have searched for India and press enter. So obviously you will be able to see different results, right? Now, out of all those results, if I click on the first result, the contents in the address bar are going to change. Suppose if I click on another result, another link, again the contents in the address bar are going to change. So the contents in the address bar is the example of a clickstream data, and the clickstream data is called as quasi-structured data. Right? So I hope Sundar Kulkarni, the concept of quasi-structured data is clear. Right? So someone, Rajeshri, is asking me, sir, JSON data comes under which type of data? Right? So JSON data is key value pair data. Right? So someone has asked me the question. Rajeshri has asked me one question that. Under what type JSON data comes. So first of all, let me tell you, JSON actually stands for JavaScript Object Notation, right? And JSON actually follows the data like this. It stores the data into key and value pair, right? Suppose I want to store a name. So what I will do is I will create a key as name and then colon and then such a, right? So this is the key and this is the value of that. So JavaScript Object Notation data, it is actually used by some databases. You might have heard about, like MongoDB is actually based on JSON oriented document, and it follows that particular data. So the question was, under which type of this particular data this key value pair data may come, right? So you can say that this data is going may come under this particular thing, unstructured data, right? I hope, Rajeshri, it's clear. This JSON data, you can say it will come under unstructured data. I hope that answers your question, Rajesh. Okay. So let me save this one. Let me clear it now. And now I will try to move to the next point. That is nothing but approaches of machine learning. Different approaches of machine learning. And after that, we will try to start the implementation of different applications. Right. So next point is nothing but approaches of ML. Approaches of machine learning. The first approach to create the machine learning model is supervised machine learning. Let's try to talk about this one. Right? Supervised machine learning. Right? The next type of approach is nothing but unsupervised machine learning. We will try to see what is supervised machine learning first, and then we will try to see what is unsupervised machine learning. And then there is something called as semi-supervised machine learning. It is also there. So semi-supervised machine learning. We will try to talk about that with the help of a simple example, and we will try to differentiate all these terms. Now we will try to talk about one more type is there, and that is nothing but reinforcement machine learning. So we have some time limitation actually, otherwise I would have shown you one example of all these types. Maybe we will try to find out some way out of that. No problem. Okay. So reinforcement machine learning. So these are the four types. Some of you might have seen that, okay, there are only two types, supervised and unsupervised. Some of you might have seen that, okay, there are three types, supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement. Right? Some of you might have come across these four types. So, right? So supervised machine learning, unsupervised machine learning, semi-supervised machine learning, and reinforcement machine learning. Let's try to discuss all these terms. First of all, what is supervised machine learning? So always remember, many times in books, you will find out that supervised machine learning is also called as parent-oriented learning. Right? Parent-oriented learning. And I will tell you why it is called as parent-oriented learning. Or it is also called as parent or teacher-oriented learning. Now, why? Why so? Why is the name parent or teacher-oriented learning? We will try to talk about that. Always remember, the most important point about supervised machine learning is data. In case of supervised learning, data is always labeled data, right? That's why I discuss about data. So data is always labeled data. Now what do you mean by that? It means that, see, in case of machine learning projects, what happens is, from the client, you will be given some data in the rows and the columns format, like this, right? Now, in case of supervised learning, if this is the data which is coming from the client, which is in the row format and the column format, right? In this case, suppose there is a column called as years of experience, right? Education level. There is a column called as address. There is a column called as age, right? And there is a column called as state, right? And there is a column called as salary, right? This is the data which is given by the client for 1000 people like this, right? So years of experience, education level, then address, then age, and then state, and then salary, Right. Now they're asking you, client is asking you to create such a model which is going to help you to predict the salary of a new person who is going to come. That means what? That means in case of supervised machine learning, you are aware about, see, this, all these columns are going to be your input column. And this column, salary column, is going to be your output column in that particular model. So output column is also called as target column. And input column is also called as, input columns are also called as feature column. So the point is, I just wanted to tell you that why, what is the label data? The label data means, see, these are inputs and this is output. The label data means you are aware about the input as well as the output in case of supervised machine learning. That means each and every data is labeled data. That means you have column names. You have column names like this. This type of data is called as labeled data. So what is supervised machine learning? Always remember, in case of supervised machine learning, the data is always labeled data, right? So what is labeled data? Again, I will repeat. Like this. If they are asking you a question to create a model which is going to help you to predict the salary depending on all these inputs, that means you are aware about the input as well as the output, and that is nothing but labeled data, right? So that's what supervised machine learning is, and why it is called as parent-oriented or teacher-oriented learning, because this input and output, this labeled data, is going to act as a parent or a teacher, right? So, or a supervisor, and that's why it is called as supervised machine learning. So it is not like unsupervised machine learning where we are not aware about the output. In case of supervised machine learning, we are always aware about the output as well as the input. And that's why it is supervised machine learning. And that is nothing but labeled data. Right. So this is in a brief about supervised machine learning. You can create a lot of projects. You can go and you can create a lot of applications with the help of supervised machine learning. Let me list down some of the algorithms which you can make use of to solve the problems with the help of supervised machine learning. First of all, which types of problems you can solve with the help of supervised machine learning? The first problem you can solve with the help of supervised machine learning are prediction problems. That means there might be a prediction of a stock market price, there might be a prediction of a result of a particular student depending on his previous results, there might be a prediction of a salary of an employee, right, depending on all these criteria. Right? So all these types of problems can be solved with the help of supervised machine learning. Another type of problem can be solved with the help of supervised machine learning are, they come under classification problems. So prediction problems and classification problems, these two types of problems can be solved by the algorithms which come under supervised machine learning approach. Now, which algorithms one can make use of to solve the prediction problems? So there is an algorithm like linear regression. So you can go and you can make use of this algorithm, linear regression, to solve the prediction problems. Or there might be algorithm like decision tree. Decision tree is an algorithm which can be used to solve the prediction problem. There might be algorithm like XGBoost, extreme gradient boost, to solve the prediction problem. There is the algorithm like naive Bayes algorithm can be used to solve prediction problem. There are a lot of algorithms which are available here, right? For example, as it's a prediction problem, right? As it's a prediction problem, prediction is also called as regression, right? So decision tree regressor, then there is something called as AdaBoost algorithm, which is also used for solving the prediction problem. There is something called as random forest algorithm, which can be used. There is something called as ANN algorithm, which can be used, right? Sorry, ANN is actually used for classification. Yes, random forest can be used for solving the prediction problems. And which are the algorithms which can be used for solving the classification problems? So for solving classification problems, you can have algorithm like logistic regression, right? Again, decision tree can be used for solving classification problem. Then k nearest neighbor algorithm can be used for solving the classification problem, right? So there are different algorithms which you can go and you can make use of for solving the classification problems. Now, what is classification? Let me give an example of a classification problem. For example, let's try to talk about current situation. If I want to, depending on the symptoms of a patient, if I want to classify a patient as a patient affected by COVID-19 or a patient who is not affected by COVID-19, right? So that's a classification problem. Or if I want to divide a person as a diabetic patient or a non-diabetic patient, right? So again, that's a classification problem. So all these algorithms are going to help you to train your model in such a way that they will be able to classify the data, right? So that is nothing but classification problems. These are the examples of classification problems. So prediction and classification problems can be solved with the help of supervised machine learning approach. Let's try to talk about unsupervised machine learning approach. Always remember, in case of unsupervised machine learning approach, the data is not labeled data. It means what? It means you are not aware about the input and you are not aware about the output. That means you will be given some data and your algorithm needs to learn from the data itself. You do not know what is input and you do not know what is output. That is, your data is not labeled data. Right. Now, what types of problems you can solve with the help of unsupervised machine learning? So, one can solve the problems of clustering with the help of unsupervised machine learning. Now, what do you mean by clustering? Clustering simply means grouping. Right. So, for this, which are the algorithms available? So, some of you might have heard about k-means algorithm, which can be used to solve the unsupervised machine learning problems. Or there is an algorithm called as DBSCAN also, which you can make use of for solving the grouping or clustering problems which come under unsupervised machine learning approach. Okay. Now, let's try to talk about the third approach, that is nothing but semi-supervised machine learning approach. So, semi-supervised machine learning approach is just a mixture of supervised learning and unsupervised machine learning. That's it. Okay. And in real time, you will see that we people go with semi-supervised machine learning only. Right. So, what happens is, if client is going to give some data, right, if client gives some data, what we people do is, we people try to divide that data into different clusters, right, in different clusters. And if there is a problem to solve and that problem is of prediction, so what I will do is, here with the help of k-means like algorithm, I will go and I will try to divide this particular data into different groups, into different clusters. Now, on every group, we are going to apply prediction algorithm. Then, for example, linear regression, right, I will apply, decision tree, I will apply. So, more than one algorithm we are going to apply on all of these different clusters, right. So, instead of applying the prediction algorithm on this complete data itself, first of all, divide that data into different clusters, and on those clusters, apply prediction algorithms like this, so that it will be very fast, it will be a parallel task, so that it will save your time. Right, and that's why, see, k-means if you apply, it will be unsupervised learning, and linear regression if you apply, it will be supervised learning, and it will be a mixture of supervised plus unsupervised machine learning, and that is nothing but semi-supervised machine learning. And that's why in many books you will see that semi-supervised machine learning term is actually not added, because it is nothing new, right? It is just a mixture of supervised machine learning and unsupervised machine learning. It is just that we are using supervised machine learning after unsupervised machine learning. That's it. So that's why in many books you might not have seen this particular term, but yeah, it is that. Okay, so that is about semi-supervised machine learning. Let's try to talk about this particular point, reinforcement machine learning, and let's see what is this. The best example of reinforcement machine learning is driverless cars. Okay, so driverless cars are the best example of reinforcement machine learning, or you can say there are a number of examples of reinforcement machine learning in robotics, right? For example, and let me tell you, this reinforcement machine learning is also called as feedback based learning, right? Or there is another name for reinforcement machine learning, and that is nothing but a reward based learning. Feedback based learning or reward based learning. Now, why it is called as feedback based or reward based learning? Because, for example, if you take an example of a car, driverless car, right? Driverless car. Now, if a driverless car sees a red signal, now what it should do? It should stop if it sees a red signal, but if it is not stopping, give negative feedback at that time, right? So that feedback will be remembered by that particular driverless car next time, right? That is, give no reward at that time. Suppose on the red signal, if the car is not stopping, that is negative feedback. So it is going to remember that negative feedback next time, and it is not going to make the same mistake next time, and that's why it is called as reward based learning or feedback based learning. It is called, right? And if the driverless car sees the red signal and if it is stopping, give positive feedback, that also it is going to remember next time, right? This is how reinforcement learning is actually coming to picture. But while saying that, there are only a few companies who are actually working in this particular area. The companies like Google, Microsoft, and yes, it is a evolving term. in near future, the reinforcement machine learning, you are going to see a lot of applications in that particular area, right? Right now, most of the problems are actually solved with the help of supervised machine learning, unsupervised machine learning, and semi-supervised machine learning, right? So, what we can do is, as we have discussed about all these terms, that is supervised, semi-supervised, and then reinforcement, and unsupervised machine learning, we will try to see. If we get some time at the end of the session, we will try to see one of the examples, if it is possible for us. Okay. So, I hope everyone has at least got the idea about all these terms. Now, I will try to go and try to go to the first application, that is nothing but voice assistant, right? And it is developed in basic Python. So what I'm hoping is that you people are aware about basic Python language. That's why I'm just saying that you people will be able to understand it, right? Even if you do not know about basic Python, don't worry, I will be providing the documentation. You just need to spend some time after the session and then you will be able to understand that particular application also. And there will be a task for you people. There will be a task here. You people can go and you can add a lot of things in that particular application. You can explore on that particular application. Okay. So before that, Shilpa Dasan has one question. Sir, can you repeat reinforcement machine learning? So Shilpa, reinforcement machine learning is nothing but it is called as feedback based learning. It is called as reward based learning. Why it is so? The best example of reinforcement machine learning, I told you, is driverless car. Now, for example, if driverless car sees a red signal, now what it is supposed to do if it sees red signal? It is supposed to stop. But if it is not stopping, you need a feedback at that time, right? So that feedback, that particular car is going to remember for next time, and it is not going to repeat the mistake, right? And that's why it is called as feedback based learning. So in that particular case, we always try to give feedback. Machine always try to give feedback depending on the task. Right, and that is nothing but reward-based learning or feedback-based learning. Driverless cars and robotics are the examples of reinforcement learning. I hope it is clear, right? That answers your question. Okay, so now let me go and try to show you the first application which I was talking about. That is nothing but voice assistant. So first of all, what I will do is I will try to show you the execution itself, and then I will try to move to the code. Okay, so let me go to the path first and try to show you what that application will be able to do. Okay, so this is a voice assistant. I have named it as a Jarvis assistant. I told you that whatever the command I am going to give it through voice, it is going to accept that particular command and it is going to do that particular task. So again, one more point I forgot to tell you: the tools, right, or the tools or the softwares, whatever I am using here. So let me tell you, I am using this particular thing. Anaconda's Jupyter. Some of you might be knowing about Jupyter. Jupyter is a notebook which is available in Anaconda. Anaconda is a distribution. It's a distribution. If you go and if you just try to search for install Anaconda, it is very easy. And again, how to install Anaconda if someone doesn't know, don't worry, it is mentioned in the document. Okay. So what I'm using is Jupyter notebook. This is called as Jupyter notebook. Whatever you are able to see. This is called as Jupyter notebook. So this is the one thing I am using. Okay. And for the Python project, which I'll be showing you, for that I am using one integrated development environment, and that is nothing but PyCharm, which is also used for Python. So yeah, whatever the code I am showing you, you people can go and you people can run within other IDEs also. For example, some of you might be knowing about something called as Spider. So yes, all the code, whatever I am showing, it is going to run in Spider also. You might be knowing about some online platform for running the Python code, that is called as Google Colab. So yes, the same code is going to run Google Colab also, right? There is something called as Jupyter Lab also, that's also possible. Or there is something called as VS Code. So whatever the code I am going to share with you people, each and everything is going to run on all these platforms also, right? This is just because, see, many people, they might be using different platforms. That is the only purpose, right? But in my case, for this session, I am going to use the Jupyter notebook and PyCharm ID, right? These are the two things I am going to make use of. And how to install them if someone is not aware about, don't worry, it is actually mentioned in our the PDF file which I am going to share with all of you. Okay, so now let me try to move to the first application. Now, this is the code of the application of voice assistant. Okay. Before that, let me show you which library I am using in that application. So this is Jupyter. I will go here and I will try to open a new notebook. Okay, and let me show you which package I am going to make use of in that application. So it's a voice assistant. So you might be knowing about this command, right? Import. Import is the command for importing the packages, right? For importing the Python package. Simple command we generally make use of. Import pyptsxt. Now pyptsxt is a package which is actually used to convert text to speech. So pyptsxt is a package which is used to convert text into speech. So let me run it. Okay. After that, I will be creating one object that is called as engine. Engine is just a variable. Yes, Praveen, that's what I said. I'll be sharing you all the IPMB files, each and everything. Don't worry about that. Those people who are asking me questions continuously, don't worry about the material. I'll be sharing you each and everything after the session. Till the evening, you will get it. That is for sure. Don't worry. Okay. So, engine is just a variable. So, I am creating an object called as engine. Engine is equal to pyptsx3. So, I am going to initiate or start this particular method, that is pyttsx. So engine is equal to pyttsx.init. That means initiate pyttsx. Pyttsx is a package which is going to help you to convert text to speech. After that, I am going to write on something like engine.say. So engine.say is a method available in pyttsx3 which is going to convert your text into speech. Suppose hello all. Suppose I am writing down something like this. Hello all. Learning Python and suppose machine learning. Okay. Something like this in IR. After that, the last method I am going to make use of to close everything is engine dot run it. Okay. Now see what is going to happen is this particular code is going to read whatever is written here. So let me go and show you.
Hello all, we are learning Python and machine learning.
I will run it once again.
Hello all, we are learning Python and machine learning.
Right? All of you people able to understand it? Right? See, whatever I have written here, it is able to read that. Right? That means it is converting text to speech. So it is all possible with the help of this particular package, that is pyttsxt, and that's why Python is very, very powerful. Right? If you try to write down this type of code in some another language, what's going to happen is the number of lines of code might increase in that case. But in case of Python, as there are a lot of ready-made packages available, that's why people are actually trying to move towards Python. Right? I'm not saying Python is the only language which is best. No, but yeah, it is going to make the things easy for you, right? How to read the PDF file? You can read the PDF file also. What you can do is, you can use some variable, right? PDF. For reading the PDF file, those people who are asking me questions, how to read the PDF file? For reading the PDF file, what you need to do is, first of all, you need to make use of some package that is called as Pandas, right? But as I am not going to discuss Pandas package here, because otherwise, you will not be able to complete the remaining session. Right. That's why those people who are asking me questions that how to read the PDF file, see, you can go and you can even ask this particular code to read the whole book. It is going to read that. Right. This is a very simple code I have written, only one line. But if you want to make it read a PDF, yes, it is able to read. You just need to import that PDF file with the help of one package that is called as Pandas. And yes, you can achieve your code. Right. Now one more thing. If you hear it once again, let me run it once again.
Hello all, we are learning Python and machine learning.
Now, if you people hear this particular application, if you people hear this particular voice, it's a female voice, right? Now, those who want to go and change the voice and make it as a male voice, yes, it's possible. If you want your own voice, that's also possible. in Python, right? So I will tell you what to do in that case, right? So this is a simple code I have shown. Same thing I have used in this particular application. Now I will move to the application itself. Now, before explaining the code, let me go and directly run it and let me show you what this application is able to do. See, it is in this application I have actually I have done it for 7 tasks. Suppose if I say open YouTube, it will open YouTube. If I say open Google, it will open Google. If I say open Stack Overflow, it will open that. If I say play music, it will play music. Right? If I say send mail to some person, it is going to do that task. If I ask it for a time, it is going to tell me the time. Let me show you. Okay. Let me go here and run.
Good morning. I am Jarvis, sir. Please tell me how may I help you.
Jarvis, what's the time?
Sir, the time is 11 hours, 14 minutes and 9 seconds.
Wikipedia, Sachin Tendulkar.
Searching Wikipedia. According to Wikipedia, Sachin Ramesh Tendulkar, listen. Born April 24, 1973, is a former international cricketer from India and a former captain of the Indian national team. He is widely regarded as one of the greatest batsmen in the history of cricket.
Play music. Play music. Open YouTube. Open YouTube. Okay, let me start. Restart once again. So, as you people can see, it was able to do all those things. I will show you the YouTube command also. I will run it once again.
Good morning. I am Jarvis, sir. Please tell me how may I help you.
Open YouTube. Open Google. Open Stack Overflow. Open Stack Overflow. Open Stack Overflow. Okay, it is just because of the background noise also, right? So see, whatever I'm talking, it is trying to recognize. So what I will do is I will just try to stop it. So I hope you people have got the purpose of this particular application, right? So these are some of the tasks which I have tried to show you here, right? So what you people can do is you can go and you can add a lot of tasks here, even though in this particular application I have added only 7 tasks. What you people can do is you can go and you can add other tasks also. So it is able to open YouTube, right? It is able to open Stack Overflow. It is able to open Google. It is able to play music. This is the task we have added. Then what we have done is, okay, it is able to ask, it is able to tell us the time, what's the time actually, right? So And it one more what you can say task which is added in this particular application is it is able to send the email to a particular person. That is also we are able to do with the help of this particular application. Right? But I did not show you this particular task here because I did not add the password. Because that I cannot share, right? Password of my Gmail ID. And that's why Wikipedia also. You have seen, right? And if you remember from Wikipedia, our application has read only two lines. Now, I will try to go through the code and I will try to show you why it has read only two lines from the Wikipedia. So let me go to the starting of the code. And let me just try to go through this code and explain you about how the things are going on. Now see, this particular thing, import PyTTSX3. So PyTTSX3 is the package which is used to convert the text into speech, and how to install it with the help of this command pip install pyttsx. Right now we have used one more package that is called as speech_recognition, right? As sr is just an alias, that is just a rename, another name for speech recognition, a shorter name, right? So speech recognition is used for what? Speech recognition is used to recognize the voice from the mic, right? So this is a ready made package available in Python. Now to know the date and time, date time package is imported. To know everything from the Wikipedia, there is a package called as Wikipedia. How to install it? Pip install Wikipedia. How to install pip? How to install speech recognition? Pip install speech recognition. Now I ask this particular application to open the YouTube and Google. So web browser we are going to need. That's why we have imported web browser. Now in this application, I ask it to play music. So what I have done is on my machine, I have in one of the folders I have MP3 files. So all those MP3 files I have saved in one folder. So to open that folder, we are going to need to open all those files. We are going to need some package that is called like operating system package, right? And that's why OS package is used. SMTP lib is used because you might be knowing about this SMTP kind of thing. SMTP is a protocol, simple mail transfer protocol. This is the protocol for sending and receiving the mail. It's a standard protocol, right? You might be knowing about this thing that. The protocol standard protocols are from 0 to 1023. Standard port numbers are from 0 to 1023. Right? For example, 21 port number is for FTP. Right? 22 port number is for SSH. FTP is nothing but what? File transfer protocol, secured shell. Right? Then 24 port number is used for SMTP. Right? You might have heard about port number 80. Port number 80 is used for HTTP, hypertext transfer protocol. And like this, there are a lot. Right, so 0 to 1023 port numbers are the reserved port numbers, and 1023 port numbers till 65536 are the general port numbers or open port numbers. Anyone can use those port numbers. Right. So as we are going to need that particular task here, that is to open the application, to send the mail. So that's why SMTP package is there. Right. Now why PY audio? Because it's a Python audio. Right. Because whatever we are going to say, it is going to read that, right? Whatever we are going to say, it is going to recognize that with the help of speech_recognition package and convert it into text, right? So that is actually done with the help of PY audio package. Again, it's a default package available in case of Python. Now let me show you the flow, and let me show you how everything is actually happening here and what are we doing here. Now see, so all these things are nothing but the importing statements of all the packages which we need in this particular application, right? Now here what we have done, this code I have shown you already, right? Engine equal to pyttsx.init sapfi. Now what is this sapfi? Now in my case I am using Windows operating system, but if someone wants to run the application, same application, onto Linux operating system, maybe on Ubuntu, maybe on Fedora, Red Hat, and all those operating systems, all those flavors of Linux operating systems. So this is going to change. What is this SAPI? SAPI is Microsoft's Application Programming Interface 5. So this will be for Microsoft operating system, right? If you want to run the same application onto Linux or any flavors of Linux, you need to change this, right? You just need to Google APIs for Linux. So you'll be able to find out a lot of APIs for Linux operating system. Right, so this is just for Microsoft operating system. Now see, voices equal to engine.getProperty voices. So all the voices which are available. Now engine.setProperty voices of 0. So this zero means female and one means if you change this one to if you change this one to zero to one, it will be male voice. Right? This is how you can go and you can make the changes in the voices in this particular application. Okay. Now this is how we write down the function in case of Python. So we have written a function called as pick. What this function is going to do? It is going to accept audio as input. Now from where you are going to get the audio? From py audio. And what are we saying? Engine.say. Just now I showed you what is engine.say. Whatever you write down here, it is going to read that. So audio is a variable. To audio variable, what is assigned? Whatever we have said, right? So that will be assigned to this particular audio, and it is going to say that. And engine.runandWait is the close method which is actually used for py data set. So this is the speak function which we have defined at the start of the application. Now there is a function called as wishme. Now if you remember, when I run this particular application, it said good morning. Now how it came to know that it should say good morning only? Because we have written some if and else conditions. What we have done? Our variable, what it is doing? So from datetime.datetime.now.er, we are actually taking the current time. So current time in this particular our variable. Now if the value of our variable is greater than 0 and less than 12, it will say good morning. If the value of our variable is greater than 12 and less than 18, it will say good afternoon. And if the value of that our is nothing, is not satisfying any of this, by default it is going to say good evening. So in my system watch, you can say it's 11:24, and that's why it is less than 12, and that's why it said good morning. So as simple as that. Simple if and else statements we have used here. And obviously, by default it is going to say that I am Jarvis sir, please tell me how may I help. Okay. So that is one thing, wish me function, which we have written after the speak function. Right. Now next, take command function. So take command function, it takes microphone input from the user and returns string output. So microphone input, that is audio, it is going to take as an input and it is going to return the string as an output. That means audio into string it is going to convert. So R equal to SR.recognizer. SR is what? SR is just a small name for speech recognition, which we have done here. See, what is SR? SR is a short name for speech underscore recognition. That is called as alias. Right. So what we have done here is in take command, we are trying to create an object called as R, and we are trying to run, trying to call this particular method, that is SR.recognizer, that is to recognize the input from the microphone. Right. And see, it is going to print listening. It is going to print listening word and wait for 1 second, and then it is going to, whatever it has listened from the source, it is going to put into audio variable. And now if you see, we are going to go and call the speak function with the audio. So whatever we have said, it is just going to speak. Speak function is going to speak. Right. Now there is something called as try and accept. This is for handling the exceptions. Exceptions are nothing but the runtime errors. If it is not able to identify the voice correctly, it will say something like this, recognizing, right, for some time. And then again, it is going to So Sundar Kulkarni is saying that, sir, audio in the sense it recognizes every user's audio, but what if I want it to listen only to my voice, right? So if you want it to listen to your voice, you need to go to this particular properties. There are a lot of properties which you can set. There are a lot of numbers which are there. As I told you, 0 is for female, 1 is for male. If you want your voice, what you need to do is you need to record your voice and you need to hard code your voice in that particular page. That means you need to go and you need to create your own module. How to create the module? That is, for that you need to write on a separate Python program. So I hope this clears your doubt, right? Yes, you can go and you can have your own voice also, but you need to write on a separate module for that in Python itself. So I hope whosoever has asked a question, it answers your question. Okay. So this is what I was talking about. Recognizing, it is going to recognize that particular audio, right? So it has printed this one, if you remember, right? And it is going to make use of a method called as recognize underscore Google. So audio is the audio which we have talked, right? And what is this language? EN-IN. This is the encoding by default. If you do not give it, no problem. And it is going to do what? Print. It is going to say this particular thing, right? User said, so whatever we said, that particular thing we are going to assign it to this particular variable. And if some exception is there, that it is going to say that again please, and it is going to return the query. So in query, what we have, whatever we have said, right? That particular thing we have in query. Now from this point, the tasks are going to start. The first task is sending the email. So you are going to need two parameters, to and what is the content, right? So SMTP lead dot SMTP, right? So SMTP lead is a package as shown in that you have a method called as simple mail transfer protocol. So here you need to give some email address, right? Maybe from which you are going to send, and port number, right? And then here, in my case, yogeshpm555@gmail.com. This is my email address. I need to provide the password here, right? And server dot send email. So we are going to send the email from this particular email address. To whom you need to mention the email address here, and what is the content you need to mention here. Okay, that is for sending the email, and that email task actually is completed at the end of this particular code. Now this particular line is going to be the start point of this application. So our application is always going to look for this name, underscore underscore main underscore underscore. So by default it is going to start from this particular line, and see as and when it sees this particular line, so this is the starting point. This is the starting point in our application, right? Now as and when it sees this particular name, underscore underscore main underscore underscore, it is going to call this wishme. Now what is done in wishme? So in wishme I already shown you, this is what we have in wishme, right? Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. That's what it is going to do. Now it is going to take the command from the user. It is going to store it into query, right? If user says Wikipedia, it is going to say searching Wikipedia, and it is going to give the information from the Wikipedia with help of this particular package, wikipedia.summary, and it is going to read, by default it is going to read only two sentences. So that's why I said that we are going to read only two sentences. If you want to read each and everything from the Wikipedia for any celebrity, right? So we said Wikipedia Sachin Tendulkar, right? So you can go and you can do it for any other celebrity like that, right? So yes, I have asked you to read only two lines, because otherwise it would have taken a long time, right? So sentence is equal to two. That's what you need to do here, right? And obviously it is going to go and call this particular speak function which we have written at the start of the code. Now for opening the YouTube, what we have done, web browser dot open and then the link, that is youtube.com. For opening Google, web browser dot open google.com. For opening Stack Overflow, web browser dot open stackoverflow.com. And now for playing the music, what I have done is, on my machine in D drive I have created a folder called as YouTube Music, and in that particular folder I have put all the applications, right? And how am I opening that folder? OS dot list directory. That means whatever is there in this particular directory, we are just going to list it out, right? And then it is going to play the song. That's how you are able to see the names of the song. So, and then os.start file. So it is just going to check the path, right? So whenever I say play music, it is going to open everything and it is going to play the music. So os, operating system dot list directory, is going to show you all the files. Now here, now some people might be having a question that, okay, what I have done here is I have put my own MP3 file, right? If someone wants your application to play the songs from internet, maybe from Gaana.com or maybe from some other website, yes, that is possible. That's why I said there are a lot of things which people can explore in this particular application. Right? Now I said the time, so it was able to tell me about the time with the help of this particular method. It was able to tell us what the time. So someone is asking me, Pramod is asking me a question that, sir, can we give multiple inputs like open YouTube, just YouTube, check YouTube? No, you cannot. I will tell you why not. Because if you want to do that, see what is the keyword I have used? I have used open YouTube. So if you want to use multiple keywords, you need to give OR here, like this. OR, right? It should be a vertical line only. So I should give OR like this. And then here you need to write down open the YouTube like that. In this case, you should say open YouTube only, right? So I hope, Pramod, it's clear, right? That can be done, but you need to add all those things here. Okay? So I hope it's clear. Let me show you what happens. See, here I need to say play music. If I say play song, it is not going to do anything, because the keyword is play music. This is the keyword I added, right? Let me first finish this particular application. And finally, we have actually ended up with the send mail application, right? Now let me run. Someone asked me that particular question. Let me show you. See, if I say play song, it is not going to do anything. Let me run it once again.
Good morning. I am Jarvis, sir. Please tell me, how may I help you?
Play song. Play the song. Play music. So I hope you people are able to understand, right? Whenever I say play song, it's not going to work because I have used this particular word, keyword, in my program. So those people who want to work this application by using different strings, yes, you need to include all those things, right? And that way it's possible. Okay, so this is the first application. I'll be sharing the code for this particular application. This code I'll be sharing with you people. Your job is to run the application onto your machine the way I run it on my machine. And in that, if you face any difficulty, you can always contact me. I'll be sharing everything. Right? I will be sharing the contact and the email ID at the end of the session. Right? Now, this is about the RSS assistant. Now, let me go and try to discuss about the next application, that is nothing but DRS. And I think DRS application, I need to go through that faster because we have very less time left here. So what I will do is I will just run that application. I will not go into the explanation of that. I will share the documentation for that because I need to show you the project, right? That's all. So I will go and try to show you the next application, that is nothing but DRS app. Okay. Before this, let me show you what will be the input to the DRS app. So I will go to the folder where that particular DRS application is kept. Again, it is written in the code is written in Jupyter only. So let me go to the folder where that code is put. Foster. Here it is. Yeah, see. Now to this application, we are going to pass video as in. So there are 2 to 3 clips I have here from some of the cricket matches. So if I try to show this particular clip, let's see. Particular video file. Okay, so what I have done is I have created an application which is going to help on field umpire to make a decision. So it is just like a DRS system. Now those people who want cricket matches, they are very much aware about what is DRS, right? Decision review system. So what am I going to do here is I am trying to develop something similar to DRS system here. In this case, the clip which I have shown you, that is clip.mp4, this is going to be the input for this particular application. Okay, so here if I go and try to show you where you can add a new clip, right? Or whatever the clip for which you want to run this particular application, so this is the place, right? And as I told you that we have a very less time left here. So what I will do is, instead of going through the code, I will just try to run it and leave it here, and I will be sharing the document for this one because I want to go and try to show deployment part, which is very very important. Okay, so let me go and try to run this particular application. It is going to give me one GUI, graphical user interface, right? And using which we will be able to see whether the player is out or not. Now, yeah, it has opened something. Now see. And again, you people can modify each and everything for this particular GUI. Now, in this page, in this particular user interface, I have added my image, right? So because I had that image only, you can go and you can beautify it. That's possible. Now see, here if you can check, there are different buttons I have created. Now creating the buttons and all those things, it's very easy in Python. Once you go through this code, you'll be able to understand that, right? So see, there is some button called as previous fast, previous slow, next fast, give out, give not out, right? Now these are the things which are there in DRS system, in real-time DRS system also, right? Now suppose if I click on next fast button, now see, I'll be able to run this particular video the way I want. Now see, whenever I click on next fast, it is giving me speed is 25 plus 25. If I click on previous fast, the speed will be minus 25. Now see, if I click on next slope, speed will be plus 2, and previous slope, speed will be minus 2. Right? So see, everything it is going to record. See, you can check it. Right? Now, I will click on next fast. Now see, I'll go on clicking on this one. Now see, let's look at this one. Now see, if I click on next slope, I'm able to see whatever is going on here, right? Next fast. Now, here empire is confused. Actually, this video should be a very, very small video. Okay. Some of you might be having a question that, okay, why the uniform is changed, the uniform color is changed? Because ideally, there should not be any audio in the video. And in our case, as there was audio in the video, that's why the color of the uniform is changed. Because some people are asking me some questions, how the color of the uniform is changed. So if you want to keep the same color, do not provide the video which is having audio. Okay. So I will click on next row here. Next fast. Okay. Now see, here you'll be able to see whether the player is out or not. See, it is saying decision pending. All those things we have taken care of. Let's see. I'm clicking on next row. Now the player is out. Right? Now I want to make a decision. So I will click on give out. As and when I click on give out, it is going to show me exactly. So what I have done is, whenever I click on give out, it will wait for some time. It will print decision pending, right? It will print decision pending, and then it will show some ad, and then it will show you the final decision. Let me give out. Let me click on give out. Now see, decision pending, some ad, I have shown my own ad, and then out. Final decision is out. So again, you just need to adjust all these images. That's why it's not that much good. But yeah, I told you, these are just the fancy things. You can go and you can create your own UI also. So these are the these photo and all those things. I have actually edited that. So you people can use good text instead of that. Okay. So what I have done is, if I want to show you all this, you see, these are the images I used. So everything I am going to forward to you people. You just need to run. You don't have to do anything. You just need to run this particular application onto your machine. Let me show you. These are just the images I have just embedded the images into the GUI. See, all these images in the JPEG files, right? So see, now I hope you people have got the idea. So once you receive this particular application, you will be able to receive all these files, and one of the important files is IPY and defense, using which I have run the code. Okay. Now let me go and try to show you deployment. So if we are using Fedora, what the keyword we need to use, sir? So on Fedora, Sharnama, it is going to run. Don't worry, you don't have to use any other different thing. It is, this particular code is going to run. Right. And again, let me tell you, I know as we have limited time here, and I'm not able to complete each and everything in detail. But if you people are interested, if you want to develop this kind of applications, definitely I'll be sharing my contact, I'll be sharing my email ID, whatever the query, whatever the doubts you'll be having. When you start running all these applications, you can ask me anytime. Don't worry about that. Okay. So I will leave this particular thing here itself, because otherwise we will not be able to complete the project and the deployment part which I want to complete here. Okay. So with this, I will move to the project which I have developed in PyCharm. Okay. And for that also, I will be sharing the detailed document. I will show you the document also which I am sharing. Okay. Let me go to the project itself. The next point is the project. What happens in that project is, we are able to fetch the real time data from the e-commerce website like Flipkart. Okay. Real time comments, real time reviews, real time ratings given by the customers. All those things we are able to fetch with the help of Flipkart from that particular project. With the help of that particular project, you go and try to show you the reviews. The name is Review Scraper. So see what you people will be getting. You people are going to get this particular zip file. Okay, I have unzipped it on my machine. That's why I am able to see this particular folder. You need to open this folder Inside that, you'll be able to see two folders, first class and dot idea. See, why am I doing it like this? Because this is the process we follow when we want to do real-time projects. Okay, this is one of our real-time projects which I'm trying to show you and which I'll be sharing with you. Right. So inside that Heroku class demo master, you will be able to see first class folder and dot idea folder. Double click on this one, you will be able to see all the files which you need to run this particular project on your machine. Right, and out of that, this app.py is the file in which you will be having the code. Okay. Now, let's try to see. Yes, I'll be sharing the code, Mohammed. I'll be sharing the code and everything. Don't worry about it. Right. Now, what you people need to do is to run this particular project onto your machine. You people need to have something called as PyCharm installed onto your machine. So you'll be getting this particular document. This is a PDF which I'm sharing. In this PDF, I have mentioned each and everything from the start. That is how to install PyCharm. What is the project all about? Right? What is the basic idea about the project? All those things are actually mentioned in this particular document. Right? So that's why I told you that. Don't worry. The screenshots are also given. See how to install PyCharm and all those things. So if you do not have PyCharm IDE installed onto your machine, you can install it by following this particular document. And deployment part is also shown. Whatever I am going to show you next, that particular part is also shown here. So in detail. Okay. So this is our final application with screenshots. So it's a 25-page document, which is step by step. So don't worry about it. Okay. So again, I will put that folder inside this one. I will open this particular file with PyCharm. So like this, you need to open folder as a PyCharm edition. Okay. Now, in my case, as PyCharm IDE is already installed, that's why it's going to open this particular project into PyCharm. And let's try to see what it is going to do. And let's try to run it. Okay. Before that, let me show you what it will do. See, it has opened that particular thing into PyCharm. It's loading. This is called as PyCharm. Many of you might be familiar about this IDE. Okay. And it is nothing different. Okay. Those people who have not seen PyCharm anywhere, don't worry. It is nothing new. It is similar to other IDEs. Like you might use something called as. See, those people who are asking that, can we not do the project work in Jupyter? Yes, you can do. But you will not be able to deploy your application onto cloud if you try to develop your application into Jupyter, right? And if you are not able to deploy your application onto cloud, other people will not be able to use your application. And if other people are not able to use your application, what is the use of developing your application? For example, WhatsApp is a product of Facebook, right? Now the people who have developed WhatsApp, if they would not have deployed it onto cloud, you would not have been able to use it, right? So there is no use of that application then. So the people who are asking me that, can we not develop this particular application in Jupyter? Yes, you can. But whenever you want to use that particular application in real time, you need something like IDE. VS Code ID, PyCharm ID, which is going to help you to make the things easy for deployment. And that's why we use PyCharm kind of ID. And in real time, we use PyCharm or VS Code only. Right? So I hope it answers your question. So Jupyter is just a notebook. At the start, if someone is using this kind of notebook, that is okay to learn the Python kind of language. Right? But to develop real time of projects, you are going to need PyCharm kind of ID. So let me show you what this application is going to do. So see, suppose if I go and if I try to search for Flipkart. Yes. Okay. Enter. It is going to show me the results. Right. Now, if I click on this one, it will take me to the Flipkart page. Right. Now see, it has taken me to the Flipkart page. Yes, it can work on Windows 7 also. Now see, this Flipkart page. On Flipkart page, if I am searching for something like Nokia, right? Nokia keyboard. Now it will show me some results. After this one, suppose if I click on some result, maybe Nokia 105SS. So see, what our application going to do is, our application is going to fetch something which is mentioned here. See, our application is going to fetch these things. Let me highlight those. It, our application is going to fetch the rating given by that user, comment heading, actual comment, name of the customer, right? All these things in real time, it is going to fetch. This is what our application is. So what I will do is, in our application, I will type Nokia, and directly it is going to give me what is the rating given by that person, what is the comment heading, what is the, for example, this person is saying that just wow, nice phone, pink, and the name is Ashu Khan, right? So let me go and directly run the application or the project. So I will go to run. I will click on this one and try to show what it is going to do for exploding. So yeah. Now click on run. Now once I click on run, it should give me one link. And if I click on that link, I should be able to fetch, our application should be able to fetch real-time comments, real-time reviews, real-time ratings, the name of the product, right, and customer name. So see, it is running actually, and it will show us one link, and that link is actually for local machine. Okay. So yeah, see, now it has started. It has started. Now see, this is the link which is given. Now what I will do is, I will copy it. This is how you run the program in Python. I will copy this one, go here, and I will control V, that is test, and hit that link. It is going to open some front page. Now see, front end. Now here, if I try to search for Nokia and click on search button, it is going to show me the result. But that result is a real time result. Now see, this is what it has shown me. So see, the same thing it is showing you, which I have read just now, if you remember. See, product was Nokia. Ashu Khan was the name of the person. Rating was 5. He said just wow. And the comment was nice phone and some emojis. Right? Exactly same thing. Another person is Anshul Sharda. Rating 5. Comment heading is terrific. And he is saying that, beautiful phone, awesome performance, delivery person was very good, thank you. Right? Now let me cross check it on the Flipkart website. Let me go here and cross check it. Now see, second person, third person, also see, 5-star, terrific, beautiful phone, awesome performance, delivery person was very good, thank you. Anshul Sharda, terrific, right? Just wow, nice phone, pink, Ashu Khan. So same thing we are able to fetch with the help of this particular application. Right? Same thing it is showing us. See, Ashu Khan, rating 5, Anshul Sharda, and all those things. So this is what our application is going to do. It is not limited to mobile phones only. You can go and you can search for any product. Mobile phone is just the example I have given. Right? So suppose if I go and try to search for anything, it is going to show me. Right? If I go and if I try to search for iPhone, or for any product, not only mobile phones, for any product, you can go and search. If it is available, it is going to fetch. If it's not available, then it is not going to fetch, obviously, right? So this is how you can fetch the real-time comments. Now see, for iPhone also it has fetched, okay? So see, this is one thing I can do. Now if you people want to run this particular application onto your machine, let me deploy this particular application onto cloud. Let me do it faster, because we have only 10 minutes left. So remember, when you will following these steps, what you need to take care of. Once you get this particular product, this particular folder, go inside this first flask. So you should always be in such a folder where this app.qr file is there, right? And copy this path. Okay, I have copied this path. Now open command prompt, cmd. Okay, open CMD. Now type cd space, right click and go inside that path. Now see, I am inside this first class. Cd is just a command, change directory. Okay, now you need to follow some commands. Again, these commands are given in your PDF document. Okay, remember that. These commands are given in your PDF document. Let me type first command. Don't worry about if you do not have a Heroku cloud account. See, here I'll be using a cloud platform. The name of the cloud platform is Heroku. There are other cloud platforms also, Amazon Web Services. There is a cloud platform like Azure, Microsoft Azure. There is a cloud platform like Pure. There is a cloud platform like Google Cloud Platform, Alibaba Cloud, and so on. Right? So many of you might have heard about Amazon and Microsoft Azure, or maybe Google Cloud Platform. Right? But why am I using Heroku Cloud? Because Heroku is free. It is not going to ask you for credit card details. It is free for 2 years, and you can deploy at most 5 applications. Right? And if 5 applications are already done, delete the previous application and then again you can deploy. So like this, you can go and continue for 2 years. But if I talk about others, they will ask you for credit card. Right? Obviously, they are good, but many people, they do not have credit card or such kind of problems come. That's why I prefer, for practice purpose, I will prefer Heroku. Right? So Heroku is also one of the clouds on which you can deploy the particular application. Right? Now I will deploy it. I will show you practically how to deploy it, and then I will send you the link for this particular application so that you will be able to access this particular link. Okay. Now, first step. What is the first step? So the first step is you need to fire this command. Heroku, there are only 7 steps. So we will be able to complete it in 5 minutes. Just wait. Hold for 5 minutes. Hold on. Heroku login. Once I click on Heroku login, it should take me to the press enter once again. It will take me to the login page. It should open the browser automatically, and it should take me to the browser page, and it should show me login button. So that I will click on that login button. Right? See, it is taken me to the browser, and now I will click on this login. Once I click on this login button, see, Heroku is a cloud. Creating a Heroku account is a 2 minutes task. It's not going to take that much time. Once I click on that login button, come to the command prompt. Now see, it will show me that I am logged in as yogeshpm555@gmail.com. That is one. That is first command. Okay, the first command is Heroku login. Now the second command. The second command is Heroku create. Now, what is the name of the application you want to give? Suppose I want to give application name as India. Maybe India 999. So Heroku create India 999 and press enter. You should give such a name which is not taken earlier. Okay. So see, it is creating India 999. It has created. So Heroku create name of the application is the second command. Now third command. You people can go and you can write down all these commands if you want. Okay. So that you can remember the sequence. So Heroku create is the second command. Now there is something which is called as Git. Git we are going to make use of as a repository. Repository is something where we are going to store the code. Okay. So next command is, again, as I told you, explanation of the command is also given. Okay, if someone is not able to understand here, wait for some time. Git is a command to initiate Git repository. Repository is some, so you might have heard about GitHub. On GitHub, we can store something. So GitHub is nothing but a repository where you can store something. So we are going to store our code or whatever we require to run a particular project onto Git repository. So that's why I will initiate git with the help of git init command and press it. So this is what it is going to show me. Reinitialize existing Git repository. Okay, that is one. That is the third command. Now the fourth command in deployment will be, if you want to check the Git status, it is not a compulsory command. You go and you type git that command. Right? So nothing to commit. Fifth command will be git space add space dot. That means whatever is there in the current directory, that is this one, I want everything to add onto Git. So this single dot means what? Single dot means current directory, right? Those who are aware about basic Linux commands, they might be knowing about all these things. So single dot means current directory, and double dot means previous directory. Right? So git space add space dot, and press enter. That means try to add everything which is in the current directory onto Git to present. So it is not going to show you anything. That means we are on the correct path. Sixth command will be whatever we have done, commit that. So git space commit space hyphen am and single or double quote, you need to write on something, some string, hello, hi, how are, anything, whatever you want, or your name. So git space commit space hyphen am space hello. It means that whatever we have done, we want to save that and press enter. Right? So now the only one command is remaining, that is Heroku push git push Heroku master. That means push our application onto cloud. So the command is git push Heroku master. This is the command to push your application onto cloud and press enter. If everything is okay, right? What is the name of the application? India 999. If everything is okay, it is going to deploy your application onto cloud. Otherwise, we'll have to run some other command if it shows some problem. Let me press enter. Now see what it is saying. It is saying that Fatal repository. So it has detected some another name. It has not detected this name. India 999. So what we need to do is we need to tell our application. We need to tell Git that this is not my application which I am trying to deploy. My application name is India 999, but it has detected something else because in my case I had deployed so many number of applications. That's why it has detected. That's why it has detected one of them which I have already deleted. So for that, the command is if this type of error comes to you, you need to fire this command: Heroku git colon remove space hyphen a, and then name of your application, India 999. That means we are telling Git that this is not my application. This is what I have named my application, India 999, and then press enter. And next. So it should set the repository to India 999. Now see, set git remote to India 999. And now again enter git push Heroku master command. Again hit this command, git push Heroku master. And let's see now if it deploys our application onto cloud or not. Let's see. Now see, it has started deploying the application. Right? There are only 7 steps. Again, I will repeat. All these steps are included in the PDF document. Yeah, and even if you have not written it, no problem. Now see what it is doing. It is installing SQLite 3, that is database. It is installing Python 3.6.1. All these things it is putting on to Git first, right? And if everything goes well, it is going to show us a link. Now see, in my case it has shown me a link. Let's wait. Let it complete. Now yes, see, it has completed. Now what I will do is, see, this is the link it has provided. Now what I will do is I will try to copy that link and I will send that link to you people also, so that you people will also be able to use my application. I will have to go here, edit, mark, and copy it. So this is the link. See, india99.herokuapp.com. Go here, copy that, open the browser. Hit that link here, paste it here, and press enter. Now it should open the search page. Now see, yes. Now what I will do is, I will send this particular link to all of you. You people tell me whether it is working in your case or not. Okay, I am sending it to everyone in the chat box. So let me copy paste it in the chat box, and people will be able to access. Just check, all of you, just check. Hit that or copy that link. Hit it onto the browser. Sir, what about ThinkStick Cloud? I am not getting your question, Shilpa. Shilpa, I am not getting your question. So all of you, let me know whether it is working in your case or not. Just either yes or no. Whether working or not. I have sent the link to all of you. You just need to copy that and hit it. So many people are saying it's working. That's good. Right? It is good. Right? So see, it is because of the time limitation. Actually, I am not able to go inside the code and explain you each and everything. Sorry for that, but yeah, in document, in this particular document which I have shown in the PDF file, each and everything with steps in detail is given in that particular document. What you people need to do is, you people need to go and run that particular application and follow the document. That is you people need to spend some time on that, right? Because with the help, see, this is done for Flipkart. Again, let me tell you, this project is going to work only for Flipkart. If you want to develop it for Amazon, you need to follow the same steps. If you want to do it for FirstCry or for that matter for any other e-commerce website, you can go and you can do it. Let me show you. There are different government portals also, right? For example, there are different portals. Like in Maharashtra, there is a portal called as Vahan. So if you go to the Vahan portal, and if I try to enter the bike number or any vehicle number, it is going to show you all the details about that bike. What you people can do is you can save that details and you can create a project where the person enters his or her bike's number, he will get all the details. Or for that matter, anyone's bike number, he will get all the details. Now see, in some cases, if it is showing you application error, right? If it is showing you application error, it might be because many people are hitting that particular application at one time. In your case, if it is showing you application error, what you do is, I will try to give you another link. There are other applications also, in my case, which are already working. So let me show you another link. For those people who want to run it onto their machines, you can go and you can see this is a Heroku. Once you create your application, you'll be able to see this kind of GUI. Right? Creating a Heroku application is creating a Heroku account is actually not at all difficult. So let me show you the link. So in your case, if it is not working, you just need to go and click this link. Yeah, this one. So those people who are saying that it is actually an application here, you can try out this particular application. Because as many people are using this particular application, that's why in some cases they are there. Now see, try out this particular link also. Second link also I have sent you in the chat box. You people can go and hit it. Okay. So yes, all of you, as I told you, for this particular project, this document is enough for your reference. As because of the time limitations, I am not able to go inside the code and explain you each and everything line by line. But I will suggest that, I will recommend that you go through this document. Okay? You will be getting everything at the end, today evening only, you will be getting each and everything. So see, each and everything is explained here. So please try to refer this. Because I will assure you that you will be able to create this kind of projects. Yeah, it should work. Yes. Okay. So I think because of time limitation, we need to stop. Let me unmute madam so that she will. Okay. Before that, many people have asked me. Let me share my WhatsApp number. If you have any doubt, you can always WhatsApp me. 9657080095. This is my WhatsApp number. Okay. And my email ID is yoghpm5555@gmail.com. Okay. So those people who are asking me about the contact details, these are my details. And one more thing is, those people who ask me about the recordings and all those things, what I will be doing is, you will also get the recording of this session. You just need to go to this particular YouTube channel. This is my YouTube channel where I have implemented different machine learning algorithms. There are different sessions about machine learning, big data analytics, Python language, R language, deep learning, then analytics, data science, right? Then Hadoop, Spark, Edgebase, Hive. So this is my YouTube channel. You just need to write on Yogesh Murugappa. Here you will be getting the recording of this particular session. Okay. So if you just go and if you try to search here, Definitely, I'll be searching, I'll be putting that particular video with the name of this particular session. So, let me unmute madam. Yes, Asra madam, I think you will be able to unmute yourself. Please try to unmute yourself. Yes, madam, you are audible now.
Yeah. I'm really thankful to Yogesh Murumkar sir for his wonderful session, for giving information about difference between data and information, about the types of data, approaches for machine learning languages, and then the different methods in machine languages, and then introduction to machine learning, etc. But one doubt I have, sir, right now, I just want to clear. Just tell me in a single line, what will be the difference between a neural network and a deep learning? Because I too get confused most of the time. Just can you elaborate this in just 2 or 3 lines?
Neural network is a part of deep learning.
Yeah.
Deep learning makes use of neural network for creating different models.
So it is basically the difference between the number of hidden layers?
No.
Okay.
In case of neural network, you have hidden layers, you have regularization parameters, but neural network is a part of deep learning. Deep learning is actually a wider area as compared to neural network. And deep learning starts itself with neural network. So it's a small part of deep learning. In simple words.
Okay, sir, I'm very thankful to you for your wonderful session. And I think so all the links, whatever the participants wanted, is already shared on the screen. Even if a screenshot can be taken. And later on, if anybody wants, can go through it. And here, Anand sir has already shared the feedback link. I request everyone to click that link and enter the information, and so that the e-certificate will reach to your email IDs. And if there are any doubts, you can ask sir right away.
Yeah. So if you people have any doubts, edit me in the chat box, right? Because it will not be possible for me to unmute all of you. It will be a chaos kind of thing. That's why if someone is having some doubt, you can just ask me in the chat box. We can wait for 5 minutes, right, madam? Can we?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, Varsha, I told you, my YouTube channel is this, which you are able to see on the screen, with this name. If you just search with this name, Yogesh Murumkar, right? And those people who work in colleges, we also provide paid internships also, right? Because I also look for students who are very much interested in developing projects. So, because it is good for me also. We are a people of 25 people. And we have just started before 2 years only, and we work in machine learning and deep learning and AI, and use the technology of tools like Tableau and Power BI and Python and R language and Java language. So we also look for people who are interested in developing projects, right? That's why I actually go for this kind of seminars or webinars, so that it will be good for me also and many people also, right? So Varsha, this is my YouTube channel. You can follow it. There are a lot of algorithms which are already implemented here. Refer it, and your recording also I'll be uploading on this particular chat. Okay. Yes. If you are interested in internship also, you people can always contact me. I'll be giving you smaller task first. If you are able to do that, then only you'll be selected for the next round, and it will be online. No worries about it. You just need to do the task as per the time. That's what you need to do. Yes. Thank you, Pranita. Yes. Thank you, Rekha madam. So, if anyone is having any technical question, then you can ask. Okay, no problem. I think, madam, everyone is done.
Okay, sir. Shall we stop the session, sir?
Yes, madam. No problem.
You can end from here.
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, all of you. Thank you. Bye.